just welcome, and hopefully we'll get to know each other. It's a pretty intimate conference with about 25 of us here. Different sessions will be joined by about 10 to 25 students, depending on the session and their class schedules and that kind of thing as well. Let me just turn it over to Phil first, and then we'll go from there.
Yeah, so welcome. I just wanted to take a moment to welcome you to Redeemer University College. Thank you for coming. I'm Phil Tucson. My role here is the Associate Professor of Education and Director of Teacher Education. Redeemer, we have a Bachelor of Education program. It's accredited by the Ontario College of Teachers, and part of our mission is, let's say, teacher education for faithful, effective, reflective, professional practice. And a big joy for us in one of our areas of concentration certainly is foundations and history of education, both globally, internationally, nationally as well, and specific to Ontario. And so the Margaret Eaton School Collection certainly is a foundational piece when it comes to what's going on in education in Ontario. So we're just really grateful, first of all, for the collection. You can see the artifacts at the back as well as online. Grateful for folks from the library, Tricia Cook, thank you for the display and for taking care of all of that. But today especially, to gather as a community of academics and scholars and friends to dig into the archives and to find out what's there and to have some time of concentrated attention to the gift that's in the collection. So we're just grateful you're here. Hope you feel welcome. If you need anything, I'm Phil. You've met John, of course. But yeah, welcome. We'll have a great day together. Thanks.
All right, and then ready for some of you, if you do need washrooms, there's a male washroom just to the right, and if you go to the end and all the way to the end of the hallway, there are female washrooms there as well. So let's go. The Margaret Eaton School, I'm just going to share a little bit. I'll let the other presenters, I don't want to steal any thunder from the other presenters, I'm just going to sort of share my story, just a little bit about how this whole coaching came to be. And it was my PhD studies in 1989. I was thinking about a topic. Well, actually, before that, I was thinking of the university to do my PhD in. And I asked my colleague John Brent, who was at SUNY Buffalo, and suggested I look at that place as a possibility. So I went there, and it seemed good to me. So I went there. Dr. Button was my advisor, and I was kind of interested in sort of women's issues a little bit. I have three daughters, and wanted to make sure the physical education experience and body movement was a positive one for them as young women. Have an interest in sort of marginalization, and so read a little bit about this Margaret Eaton School in bits and pieces here and there, and it kind of intrigued me. My advisor, Dr. Button, was more interested in time and sport, so I became a member of the North American Clock Association, and got magazines from them, and then another advisor, Dr. Seller, said, John, go with your guts. Which one is your gut tell you would be a good area to pursue? And so I chose the Margaret Eaton School. And basically, I began to study in 1989, and I thought, I know there's a connection to the University of Toronto. So I went to the University of Toronto, and I'm walking down the Phys Ed building, and there's an older lady, probably younger than me now, but I thought, oh, maybe she knows something about the Margaret Eaton School. And so I said, do you know about the Margaret Eaton School? And she said, I don't, but I golf with two ladies that went there. And so I was kind of like, wow, okay, so I got two addresses of two students. And I also went to the administrator in the office there, and I said, do you know anything about the Margaret Eaton School? And she says, well, we have these yearbooks, the calendars from, I think right from almost the beginning, 1901 or so, right to 1942. And she also had a list of the students from 1953. So this is about a 30-year-old list of addresses, but I had all the student names, their graduating years, and that kind of information. So the process began. Also met with Bruce Kidd, who's really supported me throughout this project, and also was pretty instrumental in the very beginning. Like 2 years ago, I met with Bruce, and said, you know, I'm doing this conference, and so we met, and he's just an incredible encourager, just kind of said, contact these people, talk to so-and-so. So he was just super in this project. But he also said, John, check the Robarts library, because he was going through the building at one point and found the scrapbook, and it was a scrapbook of Martin School, just laying around the building. So he picked it up, gave it to the Robarts library, and so that started me with more information. Then, knowing that it was part of the, it was probably connected to Timothy Eaton, the Eaton's company, because of the name Martin Eaton, checked the Ontario archives, and there's a lot of information in the Eaton company archives that are held in the Ontario archives. And then in those days, they didn't have all this digitization stuff, so I actually went through the Globe and Mail from 1901 to 1942, just sort of with the microfiche reader, a bit of gravel in the morning, and just try to find out anything I could about the school. Now we can just say, man, it'll do it. And with that beginning list of the two students who knew somebody else, who knew another student, who had a Christmas letter that went out to more students, and eventually I started getting lists of names of students and current addresses and that kind of thing. The school started in 1901. 1942 it closed its doors. It had about 420 graduates. By the time I came around in 1989, I'm going to guess half the net probably died already because they were too old. So there's maybe about 200 people maybe living still. But I managed to either interview or visit or have correspondence with a little over 100 of them. So it's about probably about half of the existing students that were still alive. But a bit more about that a little later. So the founding principal, Emma Scott, initially from Owen Sound, pastor's daughter, and was interested in painting, and went to Colorado to do some, I guess, some painting lessons. Met a Raff, and they got married. He wasn't well, I think it was tuberculosis or something, and they thought that Owen Sound would be better for his health than Colorado was. And they received one daughter, Dorothy, but he died shortly thereafter. So one of my fun tasks sometimes that we'll hold in Owen Sound maybe, and see if I can find his tombstone. I think that might be interesting for the family, and just for the family, it's fun for myself. So she was a single parent with Dorothy for quite a while, about 20 years, I guess. And she eventually moved down to Toronto. She was eclectic in her education. She'd pick up a course here, she would go there. And she was a visionary. She was romantic. She was committed to elocution. When you read about things you'll hear today too. She kind of really wanted a bit of an upper class living, even though in some ways she really wasn't an upper class person in terms of her own finances and that kind of stuff. But that really intrigued her. I think you'll get a bit more when Ben talks about that too in her play, The Message. One of her early students was Margaret Eaton, so Timothy Eaton's wife. And she was kind of captivated by Emma, and she paid the school debts, basically. I would say one of Emma's weak points would be finances. So the school always was in debt, and Margaret said, "Well, here's I'll pay them." And Emma convinced her, "I need a building for the school." And I like this whole all the Greek ideas and so on and so forth. So she got Margaret Eaton to build the school. There we go. She got to build this school, which is, it's not there anymore. This was near, it's on Bay, just south of Bloor, is where the school used to be. And so she paid the bills, and basically that worked pretty good. But initially the school was a school of elocution, and you needed to do physical education, because if you're going to speak, then you needed to have good posture, stand erect, good lung capacity. So we needed physical education to have good speakers. But more and more students were more and more interested in the physical education side than the elocution side. And so slowly it was drifting to be more of a school for physical education teachers. And and that wasn't really Margaret Eaton's interest. So in the early 20s, she's kind of going like, you know, I'm going to just stop. There's initial indications that there's feuds that they would have. And then finally in the mid-20s, Margaret Eaton stopped funding the school. And Emma, the romantic, wrote to the company, to work to Timothy, and said, you know, I don't believe in divorce. Like, do you believe in divorce? Like, she saw it as kind of a divorce between Margaret Eaton and the school. So she tried to pull out all the stops to have her continue the funding, but it didn't work. And Margaret Eaton stopped funding the school. Probably one of the significant students at the time is Dora Maver Moore, who has a significant award that's given every year in Toronto. She was, I think she graduated in 1916 or 15, I forget the exact year. So, past women. So for me, when I interviewed these women, and that's in part where a lot of the collection happened, when I went to visit these students, or these graduates, they would have a photo album, and they would say, John, when I die, my kids are going to chuck this, because it doesn't have any, these are mom's old school pictures. And so why don't you take them? Or they would have a scrapbook, or they would have some letters, or they would have programs, or a textbook, or they have their course notes. And would you want them? I said, I would love them. And so I just collected everything, and just had it in her house. A lot of the stuff was actually after my PhD was finished. I would just continue to visit. Bessie Pitt, who lived in sort of Niagara Falls area, she kept moving every few years. So we became just great friends, and we would visit every few months, and just talk. And I would often take the conversations. She wrote a little story, and our kids came, and she gave them ice cream and read the story to them. And we became friends with these people. But they were significant in some ways. Bessie Pitt. Graduate in 1925. She was a chaperone at the 1936 Winter Olympics in Germany. And she gave me her diary, which is also on the in the archives. And that was kind of fascinating. And I remember talking with her one day. She said, I went to the Olympics and as a chaperone, and somehow I think, like right away when we think chaperone, the chaperoning at Paris team, that's sort of very protectionistic and all those kind of things. But I don't think she did anything. Like, she just had a good time. She just kind of went there, and she said, okay, they're fine, they're skating, and they're, you know, I'm just going to go visit the city, and I'm going to go to the pubs, and I'm going to go to this, I'm going to do that. And it wasn't like she was, like, always hovering over them, but officially she was a chaperone. And the opening of the games happened, and she was like, I don't have a ticket to get in. How do I get in? And then she noticed that people had, like, blue tickets to get in. She rummaged in her purse, and she found something blue. And then there was a push, everybody got to get in. I guess Hitler was coming and so on. And so she just took the blue thing and put it in her pocket and just walked in. And so she was now in the opening of the 36th Winter Olympics. But how do I do? Because I don't have a seat. So she just went to the top of the stadium and just kind of hung on the edge and just watched. And then she looked down and she goes like, whoa, there's Hitler. And then she said, 10 years ago or so, said, who would have known that such a little man would have caused so much trouble? And, so it's just that, yes, there's somebody who's actually within 100 meters, say, of Hitler, just kind of living that experience and then sharing that later on. Mary Barker, a very influential phys ed teacher and leader in the Maritimes. Pauline Seller Hill, actually, just go back to Mary Barker, she showed me a diploma of her mom, who was the first woman registered accountant in North America. And wherever it said he, they had put an S in front on the diploma. So, you know, she gets this diploma, whatever. I have to actually write that all in because first time that a woman became a registered accountant. Pauline Seller Hill founded Welcome Wagon, Canada. So these are people that are, these are women that are sort of movers and shakers and trying to make a difference in the world. Dorothy Kennedy, you can't see it very well here. So Dorothy Kennedy Conacher married Lionel Conacher, they actually eloped. And, but I thought it was interesting giving this Christmas card. It's Lionel Conacher, Dorothy Kennedy Conacher, so she's keeping her maiden name, which was probably, I think, a bit unusual for that time. And again, I think it speaks to the women and their strength of character. Dorothy Kennedy, oh, that's nice, Dorothy Kennedy here. Florence Wiley, just visited her last summer, so not 2 months ago, but the summer before. She was 92, lives in Aurelia. There's a seniors complex, and there's a couple of cottages, and she lives in one of the cottages. And she said, John, in the summertime, I go for a swim every morning in the lake. She said, when I walk in, it's a little bit muddy, but once you start swimming, you don't notice it. And so, like, physical health, even as a 92-year-old, going for swims in the lake, still remained important to her. When I finished my dissertation, I invited, you can see these pictures more clearly in the back, I invited the students to come and just have a celebrative lunch. And so we had that in this building, and the picture was just taken just outside here. And this was interesting, because some of the students, like Bessie Pitt, is from 1925, and Patty Stern, from 1942, they didn't know each other. And a lot of these women did come from well-to-do families, and maintain that well-to-do-ness, marrying lawyers or other wealthy people that are wealthier jobs. And but they flew in. Like, they flew in from Vancouver to Halifax and just came here. I see Mary Barker, we visited her. She lived, I'm forgetting the name of the town, it's just north of, just a little town north of Halifax. And when we went to the town, we asked, where's Mary Barker? She said, well, just put that road there, and there's a gravel road, make a left, and when you hit the ocean, she's right there. And she is. And she was living in a little cottage, sharing the house with another woman. And I said, do you feel very isolated out here? Oh, no, because she had been like in her 80s then. Oh, no, I can just take my Jeep to Halifax, and in Halifax, I can get on a plane to New York or Toronto, and really been here anywhere. And so she was just, again, just really living independent and living a full life. Some memorable faculty, Florence Summers, wrote a book on principles of women in athletics. Was also influential in getting the Canadian Physical Education Association started, which is now PHE Canada, so the National Physical Association. She had a very conservative U.S. views on women and sport, and she brought those with her to the school. Dorothy Jackson, graduate of the school, wrote a brief history, which is on the archive table in the back of the three schools. Often I interviewed people, they would say, well, you know about Dorothy, eh? I go, I don't know. Well, and then we just go on. But I think what they referred to, I think she was lesbian, and I think for women of that time, that was kind of like, oh, it's kind of hush-hush. But so I think that's what they were referring to. On the flip side, Mary Hamilton, who got Camp Town Coon started, they would say, you have to watch her just a little bit. And I'm kind of like, what was it? And then eventually she was part of the Oxford movement, which was a sort of an evangelical Christian movement. And once in a while she'd kind of corner you, and you were kind of caught. And she would try to influence you. Students who graduated were a little bit restricted in terms of their job opportunities. Because they didn't get a provincial certification as teachers, they couldn't teach in Ontario schools. So what do you do when you graduate? And certainly it was a two-year program. If you look at their timetables, like, it was a very comprehensive physical education program. These were the best trained phys ed teachers, even today probably. If we would give today kind of the depth of the program, and they were at school from like 9 till 5, and class after class, doing anatomy, physiology, all these different things. A really comprehensive program, but you're not certified by the Ontario government, so you're not teaching. And so what do they do? Well, some did teach in private schools. Some taught at universities. You could teach at university without a certification, but you couldn't teach elementary school or high school students without a certification. And a lot of them went to the YWCA. So there's connections around the world for the YWCA. I did a paper on the influence of Martin School and the YWCA in the 1930s, especially towards the end. Almost every YWCA physical director in Canada was a Martin School grad, so they just totally dominated the YWCA. And then in 1942 was the last graduating class, because then the University of Toronto wanted to start a Bachelor of Physics program, be the first in Canada. Mario Eaton School said, if they start, we're toast. University of Toronto is kind of going like, we want to start, but we don't have any faculty, we don't have any students, we don't have anything. And so they merged. So really the university got started through the Margaret Eaton School and the Margaret Eaton School folded because of the university. I started to, so I was just busy with this kind of thing. I got an email from somebody from Fowler saying, John, we found you have an interest in the Margaret Eaton School. We have some information on the Margaret Eaton School. Are you interested in talking? We said, yep. What happens was the Fowlers bought Emma Scott's house on Oriel Street in Toronto. They were doing a renovation. They went up in the attic and they found three or four boxes of stuff. And so they said, would you be interested in it? And I said, yes, I would be. So long story short, we got their collection, and that added again significantly to the archival material. I had some students, three students go through different periods of those letters and sort of retell her story. And then one of them puts on this YouTube clip, and I thought I knew everything about Mario Eaton School, and it's not a lot. So this is Emma Scott, probably around 1920 or so. There's no sound, so that's fine. So that's just her. And I'm kind of going, well, where did you get that? Like the student, but I thought I had everything on Mario Eaton School, and the student had something. So I said, where'd you get that video on YouTube? And it's on YouTube. So I'm going like, oh. As it turns out, about a week before, it only been posted for about a week, Bob Young was a person's name underneath this video. And so I kind of go like, I wonder who Bob Young is. And somewhere in there it said Raleigh, North Carolina. I'm going like, Bob Young, that's got to be the Ticat guy. And so I started digging around. Yeah, he's the owner of the Ticats. And the Hamilton Ticats here. And so I contacted the Ticats to email, I'd like to talk to you because we have a connection with Mario Eaton School here. And why do you have this? And basically, as it turns out, Emma Scott is, Emma Scott had a daughter, Dorothy. Dorothy married Robert. Now you have Robert Young, so same so family name. And so Emma is his great-grandmother. And Bob Young got a start in a big start on the IT area, and has made a lot of money in that area. I've got to know him just as a wonderful friend, really, at this point. And so the important thing here, not only to make that connection, but then we started talking about material I had. And I just said, you know, Bob, can we digitize this somehow? And he said, okay, John, here's, I think it was like $15,000. We hired two students, and we started this digitizing process. Didn't quite get done, so he said, here's another $10,000, finish it. And so that made it possible. So Kelsey will talk about archives later. But one of the ways of getting archives is having somebody that pays the money to make that happen. So the collection was digitized. Marlene Power and Patricia, sorry. There's Patricia here. Played a major role in supervising that. Two students, Emily Power and Colette, helped us for the two summers. Well, Colette for one, Emily for both, and they did a really great job. And then Bob Young, obviously, for providing the funds for it. And then this conference wouldn't happen without their support either, because Bob says archives are only as good as people know about them. And so we need to have a conference. So he said, okay, here's $7,500, make this conference happen. And Kim Smith is one of the owners of Camp Tanum Kun, and said, here's $2,000. And so then we had money. So if you got paid to come here and those kind of things, all the food today, afterward, please join us at Southcote 53 for some drinks and food and that kind of thing. So it's all thanks to Bob and Kim. Bob couldn't make it first thing in the morning because of travel conflicts, so he'll join us wonderful storyteller, so he'll be on about 11:30 or so, sharing his stories about his great grandma and those kind of things. So what's next? Well, listen to and discuss your papers, review some of the archival materials, and then there's just all kinds of topics that begin to come out. One of my thoughts was like, even though they're yearbooks, and what were the student voices, and what were they talking about, and what were priorities for them? I think it would just be fascinating to know what that whole thing. Messaging in their curriculum and in their notes, better understanding the little theater movement, and there's all kinds of questions. But now that the archives are public to the world, hopefully that will help understand this part of women's history and the theater history, physical education, the experience of women during the first 50 years of the 1900s in Canada. So that's like way of quick intro, and why don't we just take a 2 minute, if you want to just fill up your coffee pot, that kind of stuff, and then we'll get Patricia and Kelsey on to talk about women and physical education. So 2 minute break, and then